everybody was on mute as they're coming in, but we will have some opportunities for questions and answers like before. We'll do a facilitated Q&A. So with that, we'll get started. So next slide, please. So welcome, everybody. Welcome back to the second meeting. If you remember, my name is Sherry Carter. I'm the Superintendent of Corporate Services, and I'm here to facilitate the process of this boundary review for the Stratford and area. This is our second meeting as a committee, and we're obviously doing it online at the preference of the committee. We do have others, just a kind of just a review of who's in the room. Obviously, we don't have the ability to go through all the introductions, but we should have, hopefully, we have 2 to 3 members from each of our 12 elementary schools in the Stratford planning area. It looks like we've got more joining every moment. We do have our school principals and some of our school superintendents on the line, and possibly even our director will be popping in tonight just to be to observe and support if there's questions or you know, for their own learning. I see we have a few of our trustees online to watch the meeting tonight. And then you'll remember our independent demographers, Watson and Associates. So we have Jack Amendola and Josh Valenti, who will be doing the bulk of the presentation, to be honest. Myself, our facility senior manager, Hugh Cox, Laura Morris, and we also have Bert on the line, who is our equity lead, who will be doing our land acknowledgement. So we'll move on to the agenda. So just a high level of what this agenda is going to look like. It's actually a jam-packed agenda again, just like last time. We're going to try really hard to wrap up the meeting within the timelines. I think we said we were going till 8 p.m., which may be a bit of a challenge, but we commit to getting at least through the slide deck by 8 p.m., but we want to allow time for questions throughout the meeting. So if you have to drop off at 8 and we're still asking, we're still chatting, please know that we are going to do a follow-up survey. Watson's going to do a follow-up survey, so you'll have a chance to provide more feedback and questions via that process. So obviously, we're going to do a few housekeeping items, our land acknowledgement. We're going to just review the process and committee mandate. Watson's going to share what the results of the last survey was last month. They're going to spend a little time going through the current situation and providing more info. We had some feedback that you'd like to see some more information about where students reside, for example. So there's some more information to be shared there. And then really the bulk of the meeting is going through our possible areas of change or options. And then we'll talk briefly about next steps. Now, we do have a question and answer period built in at the end, but I think I'll leave it to Watson to kind of pause when you think it's most logical. If you'd like to do some Q&A, put your hand up if you have a question. You're remotely by raising the hand that's at the top of the top right, or you can put something in the chat too, if that's more, if that works better for you. So at this point, I think, and just as a high level, you know, again, the purpose of our meeting is to share some ideas, hear some feedback. We found it very, very helpful and informative last month when we, you know, asked some questions and had some ideas shared by the committee members. So felt that was very valuable. So we'd like to kind of do the same thing again tonight, where you offer suggestions or feedback. That's the whole purpose of this meeting. So please keep those good ideas coming. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Bert, our Human Rights and Equity Lead, who will take us through a land acknowledgement. Thank you, Bert.
Thank you very much. Good evening. We are on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and the Neutral Peoples on Treaty 29 and 45 and a half. We must first acknowledge that all beings need the earth to survive and that the earth does not need us for its survival. Picture here are my son, Zachariah, on the left, his friends Paxton on the right, and Marcus in the middle. Zachariah and I are seasoned anglers. We're at a point now where when we go to the water, we know the conditions. We know them so well that it's actually not considered fishing anymore. It's called catching. We love the calmness of the water in front of us and the land used for growing crops behind us. The scenery is very serene and peaceful. Within 2 hours, Zachariah and I can haul in 3 to 5 pounds of fish fillets. For those who missed that, after several fish were caught and later filleted, we had 3 to 5 pounds of ready-to-cook food. Could we have caught more fish if we stayed longer? Absolutely. However, that does not satisfy the tenets of our treaties, which calls upon us not to take more than we need while leaving fish behind for seven generations. So here are my calls to action to ensure that I protect the waters from overfishing by doing these simple three things. Number one, I will never keep more than 10 pounds of fish in my freezer, which is enough to feed my immediate family of 32 members when the boyfriends and girlfriends don't arrive. And more importantly, if I have neighbors who are in need. Number two, when I go on fishing trips, I remind and teach those around me what it means to be a faithful steward of the earth with the concept of only taking what you need and leaving the rest. Now, the fish you see in these pictures, by the way, were caught by all four of us. We did not overfish. That's the exact same strand. And then last, before leaving the area, we gather trash, especially when it's not ours, and keep it clear for those to enjoy after us for several years. And with this, I ask you now, what will be your commitments and your calls to action? Miigwech, thank you.
Thank you, Bert. So I'm going to actually turn it over to Hugh, who's going to take us through the next couple slides. Thank you, Hugh.
Get unmuted here. So the next couple of slides are repeats from the meeting one, but we thought it was a good idea to have a little bit of a review here, and I'll try and go through them fairly quickly and succinctly. So the boundary review process, just as a reminder, is governed by AP 305, which governs boundary review proceedings. And as Sherry explicitly communicated at the last meeting, is the conclusion of this process will not result in a school closure, which is governed by policy 15. And so we are not under that process of school closure, and there will be no results like that out of this process. The intent of this process, as Sherry's kind of referred to already, is to seek feedback from school communities regarding potential solutions, which will be presented to the broader public for consultation. And that feedback from the broader public to be shared back with the committee and ultimately shared with trustees, where we would be looking for a decision from trustees in the spring, and then potentially having boundary decisions and changes effective for September 2025. But of course, there's some flexibility there, and there may be some alternatives to some things being implemented earlier. So that's kind of a quick rundown, and I'll get into some more details about where we're at in a couple of slides. Next slide, please. So the mandate of the committee, just for a quick review, again, this is a slide shared last time, just as a reminder that we will work together collaboratively and provide feedback that will help guide options presented to the broader community outside this committee for consultation through the use of a survey. While each member may have personal bias towards certain options, we also ask the committee consider the situation of all students, current and future, regardless of the school, the program, or the grade. So we kind of have a bit of a commitment to look at this in a more holistic approach versus just our own personal needs. A commitment of the members at the first meeting, we had excellent discussion, as Sherry mentioned, and it was very respectful. We'd like to continue to model this behavior, and we appreciate that there will be some intense feelings regarding the topics discussed. However, we all have a commitment to participate actively while respecting all individuals involved. Okay. And then the last slide for me here. To show everybody kind of where we're at in the process. So we had a committee meeting number one, and at the first meeting, we reviewed the boundary review process, committee expectations. Watson's presented some data on the current situation to give us all some context and some of the reasoning for the committee's work. And we're now in committee meeting number two, which is the one highlighted with the light green there. Following the outcomes of this meeting, we'll go out to the broader community to seek feedback on some options presented through a public survey, as Sherry had referenced. This survey should go out later in January. And then at committee meeting number three on February 15th, Watson will have had time to do some analysis and collate the data and share some feedback with us. And based on the results of the February 15th meeting, We will take the information to trustees on April 23rd for consideration and decision. So, and I think that could go a couple of different ways. Trustees may decide to make a decision at that meeting. They may decide they need some more time to deliberate and defer it to a future meeting. Okay, so that's kind of where we're at in the timeline. We're kind of just in the early stages and we have a little bit of work to do yet. So turn it over to Watson team to carry on with the presentation.
Great, thanks you. So I'm going to get into a couple of things. I'm going to spend a couple of minutes talking, like Sherry mentioned, about the survey, a little bit about what we heard, and then I'll talk a little bit about the existing situation, a little bit of a refresher over what we went over last time, and then I'll pass it off to my colleague Josh, and he'll start to walk you through the some of the areas of change we're starting to examine and look at. So in terms of the first survey, I mean, it was pretty high level. It was pretty conceptual. We haven't, you know, or hadn't gotten into any kind of options or areas of change yet. So we wanted to get more of an idea of about, you know, certain topics, things like busing, things like the French immersion program, and then leave it a little bit open-ended to the committee as well to give us some feedback on what you think some of the relevant issues are and some of the issues you're encountering at your schools. So we had at least one respondent from all 12 schools. So that's good in terms of participation. We had a total of 25 committee members provide feedback. So good sample size. In terms of some of the themes that we heard, you know, I often talk about boundary reviews like a recipe, and you need certain ingredients for that recipe to kind of work. And the main ones are really enrollment pressures and low enrollment at other schools, so you have space to do a boundary review. And that fit really consistently with the feedback and what we heard from the survey so far. We heard a lot of comments about enrollment pressures. We heard comments about portables at schools. We heard comments about, you know, parking availability, all things that come with enrollment pressure and high enrollments. And then we heard from other parents from at different schools in Stratford and maybe outside of Stratford as well about the opposite, about low enrollments and surplus space and, you know, some of the issues that may cause too of having too small enrollments or too small schools. In terms of some of the focuses, both what we heard at the last meeting as well as at the survey, there was definitely a focus on border crossing students. And just as a reminder, we'll go through this again, but those are students that reside in one school's boundary but attend a boundary outside of their resident area because of, and it could be a multitude of reasons, but they get permission from the board to do so. So that's one thing that, or another theme that came across the surveys. And there was another theme was, you know, if you're doing a boundary review, you know, and we've talked about this last time, there's a couple of schools, one in particular, that's experiencing some pretty significant pressures that has to be dealt with. But and people realize that, but they also said, while you're doing that, it would be nice to try to get some equity in enrollment and balancing enrollment across all the schools in the boundary review, which, again, is an ideal outcome of any review. In terms of just, you know, a couple of, you know, some of the data on a couple of the specific questions. So one of the questions we asked was, you know, how long do you think is a reasonable time for your kids, for students to be bused? In general, about 3/4 of the respondents thought 30 to 45 minutes was pretty reasonable, which is, you know, pretty consistent, I think, with at least what I hear across the province when we're doing other boundary reviews, is, you know, that 30 to 45 minute range. Then we also asked if you got specialized programming, and in this case, you know, the most common elementary specialized programming is French immersion, would you be willing to travel longer? And about 1/4 of the respondents, a little over 1/4, said they would, that, you know, by, you know, 30 to 45 minutes is the sweet spot. But of those 30 to 45 minutes, if it was for a specialized program, a little bit longer was acceptable. And then the other question we asked was specific to the French immersion program. And we asked about, you know, whether or not you know, you felt strongly about moving or relocating the French immersion program from its current 2 schools. Most of the respondents were pretty neutral in this. About 30% agreed that it you know, could be moved, and about 10% disagreed about moving the FI program. Again, probably not super surprising when we think about the numbers. a lot of a boundary review questions that we ask. It really depends on your personal impact, right? So if you have a student that's in French immersion, you probably don't want the program moved. If you don't, you might not care as much. And, you know, and then there's about 30% that, again, may have students in the program that don't mind if it's moved, or may have an opinion, even if their students aren't in the program. So that's kind of, you know, has given us, again, I don't think any major surprises in terms of what we heard from the survey, but it definitely helps to provide some feedback and some insight to see if it's along what we were thinking and to see if it was along what we felt or what we heard at the first committee meeting. So maybe, Sherry, that might be a good quick point to stop just to see if there's any questions about the survey or, you know, how I summarized it.
Okay. Anybody have any questions?
Okay, motor on. Okay, so the next things I'm going to talk about, like I said, is kind of a refresher about what we talked about last time. And also, like Sherry and Hugh mentioned, a couple of things that we added on because of some requests and some feedback from the last committee meeting. So the first slide we're going to look at is just showing you, and we'll look at the school boundaries again in a second, but these are all the school boundaries that are involved in this review. On the left, it's zoomed out, so you can see the schools outside the city of Stratford. On the right map, it's zoomed in just to the city of Stratford schools. The different colors are corresponding to the legend on the top right. So anywhere you see those cooler blue colors are schools that have a lower utilization. Anywhere you see the orangey red colors are schools that have a high utilization. And again, as a refresher, when we talk about utilization of space, we're talking about the enrollment compared to the on-the-ground rated capacity, which is the building. So it's not including if there's, you know, six portables at a school, the capacity we're talking about does not include that. It's just the bricks and mortar part of the building. So you can see, you know, there's definitely lower utilizations at the schools outside of the city of Stratford, ranging sort of in that 50% range to that 80% range, those cooler blue to green colors. And then once we get into the city of Stratford, we see quite a disparity. We see in the north schools that are in the orange and red color, so highly utilized schools. In the south, a little bit lower, still most in that 70 to 80% range, so decent utilization. And then one sort of in that 60% range. So it really varies. All the schools in the review, you have utilization rates, and you can see it in the chart on the right, all the way as high as 120% at Avon, all the way down to 50%, 51% at Central Perth. So again, thinking about, you know, the recipe analogy I gave, like you have enrollment pressures and high enrollments at a bunch of schools, you have surplus space at a bunch of other schools. The question now becomes, can you sort of make the puzzle work, right? Do you have the surplus space at schools that are within a reasonable distance and meet the, you know, parameters that we want to take up those surplus students? And that's kind of what Joth will talk about in a couple of minutes. So if we move to the next slide, the other thing, like I said, that came up in the survey and that also we talked a little bit about at the last meeting was in and out of boundary students. So this chart is similar, I think, to what we looked at the last meeting. It shows all the students that are coming in from out of boundaries. It shows in the next column all the students that move out of that boundary that go to other schools. And then that last column is the most important column that we want to look at. It shows the net result of that. So Anne Hathaway, for example, has 71 students that come into that school from other areas. It has 35 students that go out. So if all students were returned to their home boundaries, it would increase by a net of 36 students. So you can see, again, just like the utilizations, you know, maybe the theme of tonight is there's variance, right? Depending on, you know, where you are in the city and where you are outside of the city, you vary in utilization, you vary in the number of students that come in and out of boundary. A couple of quick notes on this slide. When we do the analysis, which means when we start to move students and, you know, what Josh is going to talk about, when we start to take pieces and move students out to different schools or different areas, we assume in that analysis that all students have been returned to their home area. So that's assumed unless someone tells us not to, unless the committee tells us not to, or board staff or trustees instruct us that boundary situations are going to remain, we assume that they get returned. And that's something we'll eventually talk about. That comes into when we talk about legacy students, that could play into to that situation as well. But for the purposes of the analysis, everyone goes back. The other thing I want to point out is when you look at the bottom and you look at the total, you might say, how come the ins don't equal the outs? Because there's schools in this boundary review, schools outside of this boundary review that are impacted by this in and out that we're talking about, right? So in this situation, there are more students that come into this these schools involved in the boundary review than students that leave, that go out to other schools. So that's why you see a net of 76 students. And most of that net, I mean, it varies from school to school, but most of that net you can see right in the middle at Milberton with a net of 75. A lot of those students are going to a school that's not included as part of this review. And that's why you see that net result. So I think that's all I wanted to mention on this slide. If we go to the next slide, we're going to get a picture of, again, what the elementary boundaries look like. So this is very similar to the utilization slide we looked at. It just shows you the different boundaries denoted by the different colors. And now we actually show you where the schools are located in that boundary as well. If you go to the next slide, and just before you move, important to note, just backwards, these are the regular track English boundaries of the school, okay? And we'll show you on the next slide what the French immersion boundaries look like. So these are the French immersion boundaries. So Anne Hathaway is largely a City of Stratford French immersion school. So it takes in French immersion enrollment for all the City of Stratford schools, with the exception of Bedford. Bedford French immersion boundary is its own regular track English boundary, as well as all the schools in this review outside of the City of Stratford. So those are the two French immersion boundaries. Again, they are distinct from the individual English boundaries that we looked at the previous page. Next slide is we're going to get into, again, showing you the school boundaries. And what one thing that we were asked to look at in a little bit more detail, we showed you some high level numbers last time of the cluster of students. So these bubbles represent, the bigger bubbles that or bigger circles that you see on the screen. Those are the higher number of students that reside in that area. The smaller the circle, and you see the little numbers inside, smaller number of students. So it gives you an idea of, and this is for English track only. So you start to get a picture of where the students are clustered, especially in the City of Stratford, compared to where the boundaries are. And you can start to see, why we have some enrollments that, or schools that are well over capacity and some that are well under. And some just have to do with, you can look at Hamlet, Shakespeare, and Romeo as a good example. There's three schools there, all very close in proximity. I think those three schools, I had it written down somewhere, but I think they have about 1,100 capacity or so, but there's about 800 kids that reside in that area, right? So we can see right off the bat that there's a reason why we have some surplus space at some of those schools. If we move to the next slide, it's exactly the same as what we're looking at here, but it's just showing you strictly the French immersion enrollment. There we go. And same thing, you can see the clusters are where they are in the City of Stratford. And again, probably not a big surprise that, your biggest, two things, your bigger French immersion clusters are pretty consistent with some of your bigger English track clusters, because that's just where population clusters are in general. And the other thing you start to see is there's clusters around the schools, right? And that, probably relates to, it's probably a bunch of things, but part of it is just going to be convenience, right? If it's a French immersion school that you can walk to, or that's close and easy to get to, you might be more apt to participate in the French immersion program. At least that's what these student clusters that we're looking at are showing us right now. And then two more slides for me before we look at some of the options. Just before I turn it over to Josh, this is very similar to what we looked at on the previous slide, just showing you the school enrollments with the boundary, with students going in and out of their school. What we've done here is we've actually returned them back to their home school. Like I said, it's kind of our first step in the analysis to say, okay, if everyone goes back and goes to the school they're supposed to, what's the sort of canvas that we're working with? Excuse me. And you can see that for some schools, it doesn't make a lot of a difference. But for some schools, there's a couple that, you know, pop up. Downey, increases by 16% utilization. Bedford goes down by about 10%. Milverton down by about 20%. Hamlet down by 10%. So there's a few schools in here that definitely get impacted once you start to return students back to their resident area. And the last slide that you know, we talked a little bit about last time was getting a sense, and I think a question, I do a lot of boundary reviews, so I might be getting mixed up, but I think it was asked, like, when we look at the methodology for projecting enrollment and we're, you know, looking at these decisions, are they a snapshot in time or are we taking into account kind of what's going to happen in the city of Stratford? And the answer is the latter. Like, as much as we can through our enrollment projection methodology, through talking to the city about what their residential development opportunities are, absolutely, we try to factor that in to the projections and to the boundary study. And you'll see when Josh shows you some of the areas, you know, some of these areas that we're proposing about moving are strictly, you know, when Josh talks to you, try to keep in mind some of these giant circles that we're looking at on this map now, like, you know, almost 700 units in the top left corner. And those will make a little bit more sense when you start to see some of the areas that we're proposing about moving. The other quick thing on this slide that I want to mention is, you know, sometimes, you know, the community might be asking, hey, there's a bunch of development going on here and I don't see any of your circles there. These are all proposed future developments. If there's already shovels in the ground, if you're already watching homes being constructed, those are kind of already built into the projections, even though there might not be a student there as of yet. So I just wanted to note that as well. So again, I'll stop there. Maybe again, you know, before we turn it over to Josh, see if there's any comments or questions. And thanks for your attention thus far.
Anything in the chat? Anybody have anything they'd like to ask? I think that makes sense as most. Oh, we have do have a question from Sean.
I was just wondering, of those looking at the net numbers, do we know what percentage of the net change would be as a result of French immersion and how much of it is just geographic? It makes sense because their parents were close to the school. Do we have an idea of what that number would look like with French immersion? Because I think a lot of that, assuming a lot of that cross-border is going to be French immersion based.
No, so the French immersion has been accounted for, right? So okay. So you're only at a boundary with regard to French immersion. If you're in Anne Hathaway's boundary and you're attending Bedford, you're considered out of boundary, or vice versa. But none of the English schools, like let's say you live in Shakespeare's boundary, but you go to Anne Hathaway for French immersion, you're not considered, that's been accounted for. You're not considered out of boundary, like because you're going to the program that you're supposed to according to where you live. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. Awesome. Thanks.
Cool. Thanks for the question.
Can I actually jump on that though? The only difference would be we do see sometimes where kindergarten students will border cross in to one of the two schools because they're considered border crossers because they're not technically in the French immersion until grade one. So if a family wants to keep their child at the school from K to six, then for the kindergarten years, they're considered a border crosser. And then when they hit grade one, they're not considered a border crosser. So there is that caveat.
Yeah. Thanks, Sherry. Good point. Yeah,
you're welcome. And I think that's it, unless we have any other questions. Oh, I do have a question here in the chat, Jack. Do we have a sense of the margin of error that the kindergarten numbers may account for? So I think it's really just building on my comment now. How many of those border crossers are those kindergarten students? I think we'd have to take that back and do deeper analysis on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that we can, when I say we, I mean Josh, but it's something that he can pull for sure. Like we have all those numbers by program, by grade. And maybe if we're lucky, Josh, maybe we'll even pull it by the time we're done tonight. But if not, for sure, given to the committee in the next day or two.
And I guess the one caveat with that is when we look at the numbers, if you're in JK now and we've returned you, we don't necessarily know that you're going into FI. And if you are intending to go to FI, that may also change. So there is some leniency there on that process as well. So jumping into the options, if there's nothing else there, doesn't look like it. So I'll jump right in. So the approach for tonight is we've identified six different areas. So we'll walk you through each of those areas as kind of identified on the map here individually. And then the three options that we have prepared are iterations and combinations of redirecting these areas to a number of schools and a number of opportunities. One, we have to see some impacts with and without some of these options coming in and out, as well as what they would look like collectively as we move through the process. So starting with area one, noting that Avon is, I'll say, the school of essentially concern here of being overutilized. With the surrounding school and the neighboring school of Bedford being overutilized, or just around utilization, we are looking to essentially make some room at Bedford so we can also relieve some of that pressure at Avon. So looking at this area one here, this is the area south of the river, currently attending Bedford for both English and French immersion. So this option area one is essentially looking to divert both French and English, because as we move that English boundary, that FI catchment area would also then be diverted to Anne Hathaway. So we're looking to move this area essentially south down to Anne Hathaway. In this area, there's about 82 students, 58 of them being English track, with the remaining 24 being French immersion. And as we see on the bottom table here, we have status quo enrollment, and then we have area one with students returned to their home boundary, and then this change happening. And as we look at that table on utilization on the bottom right, we can see that Anne Hathaway goes from 73% and it bumps up to 82%. While Bedford goes from 108%, it does gain some of that space and falls down to 80% there. So in a way, this is one of the first dominoes to allow some of that additional space that we may need to accommodate growth at Avon. So area two is part of the Avon boundary. It is the area east of Stratford Fairgrounds and north of Britannia. Again, this area would be diverting both the English and the French immersion students to Bedford. Right now, the English track students would be attending Avon, while the French immersion would be attending Anne Hathaway, but because that catchment changes, we'd be looking to make that change twofold for the English and French immersion. However, currently there are no French immersion students in this area from the K to 6 program. So there is 62 English track students that, again, we'd be looking to divert east to Bedford there. And as you can see, again, on that table on the bottom left-hand corner, Avon goes from 120% current 2023 utilization, and with this move would be reduced to 108%. So a pretty significant change at both sites there. But then you see, without the area of one being addressed here, Bedford still remains at 112%. So with this change and without area one change, Bedford starts to see some of those issues. So you can kind of start to see some of those domino effects essentially happening as these boundary changes are addressed. The third area here, again, is part of the Avon boundary. It's south of Huron Street and west of Alone Avenue. And it's, I'll say, there is some new development happening in just south of the Huron area there that some of you may know from being in the area. There is the area that is south of the rail tracks there that has developed and is quite dense in population. There are about 87 students K to 6 in that area. So in this situation, in area three, we're looking at, again, capturing those existing 87 students along with future growth just south of Huron Street there, and allocating that again away from Avon. And in this case, geographically, Hamlet's the adjacent school community there to look for. And again, yep, go ahead.
Josh, I'm just wondering if when would be a logical time to stop for questions about new development.
We can do that right now if we got one. Yep.
Yeah. So there's a question in the chat. I was waiting for you to get to the slide when we're talking about new development areas. For the new development areas, are you assuming a percentage will be French based on the existing French-English ratio? So I think wondering when you build the scenarios, are you making an assumption that there's French and English track there? And then also a separate part of the question is about, has there been analysis of whether the English-French ratio has changed over the last 5 years?
Yeah, I can start that answer. Yes and yes is basically the answer to that question, but I'll get into it a little bit deeper. So yeah, absolutely. It's something that we work into the projections, and especially assuming just what you said, that a percentage of that new development, or basically students that are new students, are going to attend French immersion program. And absolutely, we try to look at what that uptake is in the existing community, and we try to apply that to new development. Have the ratios changed? Yeah, mainly because of the pandemic. And that's why it's a little bit difficult right now to you know, really accurately predict kind of what those French immersion rates are going to do going forward, only because we had a bit of a downward blip during the pandemic. And some of it was just, it's for me, anecdotal, talking to parents, and I know board staff did, but, you know, if you weren't a French speaker when we went to a virtual learning environment, I know quite a few parents, and the data bears this out, that removed their kids from the French immersion program. So that caused a little bit of a blip for a couple of years. The participation rates seem to be coming back to what they were historically, but it's obviously something we're going to monitor over the next couple of years, because we don't know that. You know, in some cases, like these blips turn into kind of these sea change trends, right, where you start to see less and less participation in the program. We just don't have enough data yet. And like I said, the blip that we have in the data is pandemic related. So it makes it a little bit more difficult to predict. So I hope that answers your question.
I do have a question about Area 3 students of Hamlet. Basically, why the logic behind this recommendation that's on the area that's on the screen right now. I do think that anything kind of related to options or areas, we maybe want to go through the slide deck, because there is different solutions. So this isn't the only kind of solution. There's multiple solutions, and that might give you the kind of the other things that you're thinking of. So if you have a technical question, by all means ask, but let's maybe go through some of the areas and the options, and then you can see this is not the only idea that's on the table, and we're hoping that we've captured some of those ideas that you might have. Is that okay?
And maybe just to add to that, Sherry, like that's really the intention, right? Like Josh said, like we've intentionally sort of created these pieces so that if the committee thinks, just what you said, like, why is Area 3 going there? Like Area 3, it makes sense to, like, because we go to, you know, we go to the arena there, and we shop there, and we work there, and all these different things. That's exactly what we want to hear tonight, are those types of things. So, yeah, okay. Thanks.
Awesome. And I think
someone had their hand. Yeah, sorry.
But I think it's gone now.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. So moving on to Area 4. So Area 4 is part of Hamlet boundary. Again, this one is regular track change only, because we are not changing the boundary between Bedford or Anne Hathaway. So this would remain French immersion area, would still be attending Anne Hathaway. But this is the area west of Erie Street to John Street, and then north of Cambria Street, part of the Hamlet boundary. And in this case, we are directing or looking to direct it potentially to Romeo. There are 47 students within this area, Area 4. 41 of those students are within that 1.6 kilometers to Romeo. So that is that walkable distance to Romeo. They are relatively close to Hamlet as well. So essentially we are moving walkers to walkers and remaining them at walkers. In this case, they are currently they're required to cross Gore Street. We've heard that's been a main street as well. But in this proposed option, we are essentially looking to those students to cross Erie Street. So as we kind of work through these options, we'll open that up a little bit later. But if either of those streets are a concern or one's better than the other for those students crossing, as they are would-be walkers, let us know, and we're happy to have that discussion as well. So this area five is the area west of Alone, part of the Avon boundary right now. So note there are currently zero students within this area. This is a future growth area. I think it came up last week that historically this at one point was part of the Central Perth boundary. And when Stratford expanded that boundary, the board did contain that area within the Stratford schools and directed that area to Avon, noting that now we're kind of at that capacity of Avon. So where is this an area that minimal disruption with existing students, but we know there is some large scale future developments. And as Jack mentioned earlier on, there are already some applications kind of going through the motions of upwards of 700 units there. So some significant development happening in this area. Again, we could designate similar to that question of where does this area may go. It could go up to Central Perth. It could remain within the city of Stratford limits at a school that has some surplus space. Again, looking to the committee here for some direction on maybe what's best suiting for the community, keeping it within the city, sending it to a rural feel of a school there as well. Area six, similar to area five, one of those big growth areas remaining within Stratford. So this area is north of McCarthy Road. The difference between this area and area five is there are some students currently residing. There are 30 English track students in this particular area. So again, similar to area five, with this move, we would be disrupting essentially 30 students, but this does come with some large scale developments. And in terms of timing, we feel that this one's a little bit ahead of on the growth scale than the area west of Alone. So this one is, as we can already see, there's 30 students in there. Residents are actively being developed there as well. So more students earlier on in that forecast period are anticipated out of this area six. So those are the six areas. And then we're looking at option one here, which really factors in all six of these areas being adjusted. As you can see on the map here, we have area one, that area of Bedford being directed south into Anne Hathaway. With that room being developed at Bedford, we look at area two shifting over from Avon into Bedford. Areas three, we've directed to Hamlet, but once that area three is directed to Hamlet, there is some pressure put on Hamlet. So we did look at area four. Again, one of those tumbling domino effects of shifting that area four into Romeo. And then in this scenario, we do have areas five and six directed north into Central Perth as well. Sherry, go ahead.
What I'm going to suggest, Josh, is maybe we pause after each option and then we can go back to the map. And if people have questions and then we can have a chat about that. Does that make sense? So why don't you finish this one slide, which I know is the last one with option one, and then we'll go back and start going through questions for each option.
Absolutely. Yeah. So just wrapping up with this slide here. So as you can see, there's two tables, the top one being the status quo. So this is status quo, students still attending out of boundaries and everything that's enacted as of today. And as we can see there, that the Avon boundary there currently at 120%, but with these areas three, five, and six being developed, it quickly jumps up. And we can see there that 2033 number being 140%. But with all these changes enacted, current utilization would drop to about 77% over that longer term, would remain just above capacity at 106%, as there are still some other developments within that catchment area developing rejuvenation of those existing households. That number does start to peak up a little bit, but still very manageable in that regards. Another one to note here is the Anne Hathaway. Currently at 71%, with this change, with that area one, both English and French immersion would bump that number up to 82%. Longer term, remain under the 100%, but pretty close to it at 96%. What we do see here, though, is with that Bedford, you might know that over that longer term period, it does start to turn blue and get into that sub 70% number. There are a few factors involved with that. One, we've moved area one out. We've also tried to supplant that with the area two moving in, but there is the additional border crossers that are currently attending. And that number was around 40 students, I believe, there. So those all play into that, as well as we see that drop off in Bedford over that longer term. As for areas 5 and 6 being directed up north to central Perth there, those numbers are bolstered a bit from that 51% we see now to 61%. But over that longer term, it does have enough capacity to, over that 10-year period, to accommodate both those areas, current students and growth, reaching about 80%. So one of those positives to send it to one of those rural sites that has some surplus space to accommodate that additional growth that Avon cannot moving forward.
Okay, we'll pause for questions. So I first have Sean. Go ahead, Sean.
Hey, thanks. So if we go back to the map there for area 4, I know you mentioned that they already have to cross Gore Street. Gore Street's a 2-lane road. It is an artery to the hospital, but it's easily managed by a crossing guard currently. Erie is a 4-lane road, and there's only in that catchment one usable traffic light, but it's a 4-lane road that's a major artery in and out of the city. So I don't think that we can use Gore and Erie as a comparison for the two. I think we'd have to take that into consideration because Erie is a major artery in and out of Stratford.
Good. That's great. Yeah, thanks, Jim.
Yeah, we've had some internal discussions on well, and if we do make that change, what would be required? And I know the board has the opportunity to connect with the city and put in crossing guards or whatnot, what may be needed if that option does go forward. But good to note there. Thank you.
Yeah. Rick?
Yeah, that was my take on it, too. It's not an option for kids to go across Erie Street. That's just... It's a major artery. It's a highway with heavy truck traffic.
Yeah. It's the main artery for sure. Now in the comments, I'm going to start going through some of the comments. Are you done, Rick? Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off there. You're done? Okay.
No, that was it. That was my only point.
Okay. So Janie has a comment about an earlier. I agree with Morgan. I don't think it makes sense to move Area 4 kids to Romeo when they are within a 5 to 10 minute walk to Hamlet currently. Okay, so that's the Area 4. And then a question. Did you take into consideration new development outside of Stratford? For example, proposed development in Sebringville may impact Central Perth enrollment. Good question.
Yep. So although we are looking at the Stratford areas, and that's kind of what we show on the map, the enrollment projection that we do and capture all of Perth County and the city of Stratford. So those would have been accounted for as well.
Great. And then a comment from Morgan, just adding that the downtown is quite busy in the mornings and afternoons with multiple side streets for kids to cross. It becomes incredibly unsafe and messy. Lots of traffic in downtown Stratford. Agreed. And another comment about the Sebringville development, I think maybe just in response to another, that it's been in the 8 years in the making so far. So maybe a thought about how slow that's going. But won't make comments on that, but it could. Things are speeding up in terms of development. Janie comments, or maybe questions, to keep Area 4 where they are at Hamlet currently, would it make sense to bus Area 3 directly to Romeo?
And maybe I'll follow that up with, I know in Area 5 and 6, we'll look at it in a minute, of bringing those students, instead of sending them to Central Perth, we are actually looking at them coming and remaining within that Stratford city limits. What's the preference from the committee with those students that are on the peripheral? Is there a concern of sending them to a rural school, or are we wanting to send them, direct them to a city school? Maybe we'll throw that out to you guys as well.
That is a great question for the committee. I'm looking for some comments or feedback on that. That is one thing that is hard to judge, you know, what the preference is in the community. Anybody have any feedback on that question? Go ahead, Rick.
Yeah, I don't think it's feasible with the amount of development we have. And with the previous conversations we've had with the board and with Watson about how we need to utilize all of our space before they'll give us any money to make more. We can't just leave Central Perk and Downey Central without being filled up. And unless you're going to suddenly put a subdivision beside one of them, it's not going to work unless we start sending the peripheral students outside of the city. That's my opinion.
And Danielle?
Yeah, well, I live outside of Stratford, and my daughter goes out of boundary to Stratford. Central Perth would be our school generally. I think for a lot of the families probably going in this area, they need before and after school care, and I don't know if that would change, but I think for most people moving into the city, they're moving into the city for the amenities and including before and after school child care. And so I don't imagine that many of them would be looking to have their child go to a rural school.
Yeah, that's a great point. The childcare situation, and ironically, the less students are out of school, whether it be rural or urban, the less chance we'll have childcare. So it's kind of a chicken egg thing. If we had a larger, more full school, we'd have probably better success in attracting a before and after school program. So that's an interesting dichotomy there for sure. So we have an agreement from Morgan. And I think, Morgan, you also have your hand up. Did you want to speak to that? Morgan? Go ahead. You can take yourself off mute.
Sorry.
There we go.
Perfect. So I want to touch on like the before and after school programs. My child, I live in Gads Hill. My son goes to Northeast Hope, and he's bused there. And for the last 2 years, he's in SK. I have gotten a survey about before and after school care. So if we're putting all these kids back to their home schools, which I agree with, it's totally fine. I think it needs to be like an implemented mandatory thing that there is before and after school care at every school. Because from talking to community members and like my own neighbors and whatnot, people do bring their kids into town, into Stratford, because they can't find care. There isn't anything. And if you got to be at work early or something like that. But the survey I've been getting is, do you need it or not? And if we don't, we're not implementing it.
Yeah. Yeah, that is a big challenge. And we work, we don't actually provide the childcare services. We work with our CMSM, Consolidated Service System Manager, who looks with the city of Stratford, ironically, that looks after the childcare. And essentially, they will try and put in a before and after school program if there's a need. So that survey, that data goes to them, and then they try and find a childcare provider to run the before and after school program. So we're not opposed to having before and after school programs in all of our schools if there's viability and if we can, the CMSM can get somebody there. So, but it is some good feedback that we should probably, I wonder if we could, can we gather any data on that?
Would that Watson be something team? That could be sent out like when we in this survey. Yeah, because we were putting it out to the community, right? So could it be hand in hand that it's like, well, if we send you back to your homeschool, do you require this?
Yeah, I think a good question. Yeah, a good question for the community would be when we do the consultation, you know, if you're a border crosser, are you crossing because there's no childcare at your homeschool before and after? I think that is probably one of the main reasons that people border cross, is my understanding. And I think Morgan's confirming that in her thoughts too. So man, that would be an excellent feedback we could ask the community. Sorry, we're getting down off on a tangent here. I think I had a comment from Amanda before I move to the question from Rick. In addition, the rural schools generally experience more closures than schools in the city, which presents a challenge. So I think that's the weather-related closures that Amanda's referring to. And regarding before and after school, pressures are already significant in the city, even within boundaries. Yeah, their before and after school is all childcare, I understand from our colleagues, has been really, really difficult in the last 2 years for sure. I'll turn over, I think Rick has a question.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to the before and after. Like, I realize everybody needs it, but the fact, like, I'm one of the Avon parents. We had to wait 2.5 years to just only get after school care because of the amount of students that require it, and it's just not available due to staffing shortages of the program operators. So moving students outside of the city is not going to free up space suddenly. There's just not enough spaces, period, for the amount of kids. And it's just, it's a major problem. And it's only getting worse with the amount of people being added to the schools within the city borders.
Yeah, you hit it bang on. Like, that's what I'm hearing from all my clients is it's not necessarily, well, sometimes the school doesn't have space, but the biggest issue right now is what you said is lack of available resources. Like programs, I know a few programs that have closed down in the last few months, not because they didn't have enough kids, they had waiting lists, but they couldn't staff the program anymore, so they had to shut it down. So that's a real challenge, right? It's the same thing when you talk about, you know, can we bus kids here? Can we bus kids there? Like, those are all like definitive answers we'll have for you. But, you know, the question, I think one came up, like, can't we bus Area 3 to Romeo instead? Maybe is the answer right now, but the board's transportation people will give us a more definitive answer and say, you know, yes, we can, or no, because we would have to add another bus, and we don't have another bus, and we don't have another driver. And so we'll, you know, get some better answers for you on can we move, you know, things here and move things there.
One more comment on the before and after school, just agreement with Rick's comments about having to switch schools and we get added to the bottom of the before and after school care list. And then also if that's even offered at the school that you're changing to. So big concerns, I think, valid concerns by this group that we'd maybe want to explore further with the community. I think maybe we have a bit of a pause here. Maybe we'll move on to the next option, Josh, just so we can kind of keep going here. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, for sure. So I know it was lagging a bit. Are we caught up to option two now on the screen? Yeah, okay. So this option two, similar option one, has a number of those changes. Areas one through three are the same as what we saw in option one. In this option two, area four, we haven't moved to Romeo. We've left it at Hamlet there. And then areas five and six, instead of sending them north to Central Perth, we've actually directed those areas down to Shakespeare. So again, Shakespeare is one of those schools within the city that has some surplus space. Is that a more palatable option per se, rather than to send them up to Central Perth to a rural school? From the numbers perspective, as we can see here, without moving that area four from Hamlet into Romeo, Hamlet does jump up to 111% over that longer term, with a bit of a spike in the middle there as well, just the way the grade structures are. But it does longer term still pose some concerns with it being above the 110% there. As you can see, Avon and Anne Hathaway, similar results in option one. Anne Hathaway more closer to that 100% capacity, while Avon there is just above at 106%. But what we also see with that area five and six being directed to a city school, Central Perth does fall quite a bit from 61 down to 54% over that longer period of time. So again, some give and takes on what these areas and their implications on which ones we move and which ones we don't move. They do kind of all have a hand in with one another on how those dominoes do fall.
Okay, let's move back to the map on this one, please, Josh. And this really highlights kind of the question you had raised at the last option about moving outlier development areas out of the city limits or keeping them within. And I don't know if anybody has anything more to say than what's already been said on that. I think Rick addressed it well and had some agreement, but does anybody have anything that they want to ask or share about this idea of option two? Go ahead, Rick.
Sorry, it's me again. I guess my concern with this option, like, yeah, it's great to keep kids in the city limits. My concern is with Shakespeare School and the size of the property. So you end up with the same situation that we have with Avon, except Avon has space to grow and Shakespeare School is already pretty maxed out. And it's also not fully accessible as a building as it stands. So there'd be a lot more money would have to go into that school in the future to either account for that or replace it. And I feel like that's not a good long-term option.
The only thing I was going to add there is just, again, keep in mind that there's interchangeable pieces here. So there's no reason why, for example, Area 6 goes to Romeo and Area 5 goes to Shakespeare. To your point, Rick, just to keep the numbers a little more reasonable and spread out. So those are, you know, options we can play with. We just think sometimes we start with trying to keep it at one school, because if we try to think over the next 5 or 10 years as this neighborhood develops and, you know, we're trying to keep this community somewhat together going to one school and not to create, you know, additional, you know, fractionization, if that's even a word. Area 6 and 5, like Josh said, like, they look like they're going to develop at different times. So we might have that luxury to, you know, as Area 6 goes and already has students, it goes to Romeo. As Area 5 goes on, it goes to Shakespeare or whatever. Or one goes to the city, one goes out of the city. Like, you know, it's we got options with where we can send them.
In particular with Area 5, there are no existing students in there. So that area could be designated as a holding zone, which gives the board the flexibility to affiliate that with a school of choice, being Shakespeare, Romeo, Central Perth. And as that development comes on, if Shakespeare or Romeo, that school that it is directed to, becomes over capacity, they can then, again, maybe send that newer students to another school or another site, with the long-term goal of, okay, we filled up these schools. Is there possibly a need for capital there? Or does this, the development that developed, did it kind of suit where we directed it to? And then at that time, the board can make the decision to either dissolve or redirect that to a more longer term solution.
I guess my point is that having a long term solution that lands us in the same spot where there's a 2 or 3 year process to fix the mistake that we made, like what was already admitted in one of our previous Avon meetings, where moving Brown Street development into Avon has created a problem now that wasn't predicted or was not properly predicted. And I guess the kind of the point of us, you having people within the city and within the school board giving you the options, like we're familiar with these schools and these properties because we've lived here our whole lives. And Shakespeare School is not one you can basically count on for future development. It's a small yard, it's an old school, it's very old design, and it's not accessible as it is. Whereas it would take a lot less to develop a school like Avon, where we have property, even Bedford, where there's some property. Shakespeare, you would run into a big problem really fast that takes a long time to solve through the bureaucratic process that we have to go through. There's not really room for portables. There's not really room for these short-term solutions while we wait for those red tape to go through. So I don't think Shakespeare being flooded with a population is one that could even be an option at all.
Okay. And from your understanding, I'll say, is Romeo in a better position to manage that as well, or is it similar in nature?
Romeo is in the same situation. They're a small, Romeo and Shakespeare are the smallest school properties, and they're in the middle of the city where it's hard to get to if you don't live in the area. Yeah. Which is, I don't feel it's a good option. That's just my opinion on it, but I don't feel it's a good option as someone who's attended and lived in these schools my whole life. It's not a good choice.
Can I jump in really quickly? Sorry, I keep doing this, but just as a reminder to the committee, and on those, because those are really good points, right? But just as a reminder that to get capital at Avon, even if we know that that's the site that has the space that we could add on to, we need to fill up those other schools. And we've tried exactly what you said, like almost word for word, to the ministry in trying to get capital, saying, look, these are really small schools and really small sites. And even though they show up as maybe 70%, 80% utilized, they're pretty much full. And the other thing is, you know, geographically, the point you just made, we've said that to the Ministry of Ed, is that it's not really reasonable to get these students from Avon to these schools. The answer hasn't, well, it's not an answer, but you haven't gotten funding, right? So that's the answer, right? So we've tried all of those things you said. And again, those are good points. I'm not saying because we tried that we make this change, but I just want the committee to be aware of sort of the feedback we're getting on those points too.
I think just to build on that, and I know Sean's waiting to speak, and I don't think there's anything wrong with presenting the idea. And then if we do have an opportunity to go back to the ministry, we can say, we took this out to the community and they agreed with what staff have been saying, that these are the reasons why this wouldn't work. It just provides more support for our claims that we've been trying to make. I think it's good feedback. Okay, Sean's been waiting for a few minutes. Go ahead, Sean.
Oh, that's no problem. You know, with the full understanding that these are options, and there's likely going to be no 100% pain-free solution. But under this option, we're basically projecting out that Hamlet's going to be 120% capacity by 2028. I think the number was it spikes to 120 and then goes down to 111. Yeah, in 2028, 2029. Are we not under this scenario? We might have to do something else with Zone 3. To avoid that uptick, because, you know, right now Avon's at 140, projected to be 147, which is, we got to do something about that. But then we're saying that 120 and 111 is kind of okay. I think that we would have to look at that if this option, regardless of where those folks from 5 and 6 are going to get bussed, we would have to look at that, because, you know, we're kind of robbing Peter to pay Paul at that point a little bit.
And I think it's starting to, you know, for me anyways, right? But I think for the committee, you're starting to get what Josh is talking about, that there's this domino aspect to it, right? And some of the questions like, why are we moving Area 4? That doesn't really make sense. Well, because if we don't, then we have to it becomes this like balancing act, right? Where you're just what you said, you're trying to like, oh, damn, if we move that, then we can't do this. So yeah, it's exactly that.
Okay, I've got a few comments and questions in the chat. So Morgan is just referring to, I think, the conversation we were having about Romeo and Shakespeare buildings and properties, that they're both residential, one lane side street with zero parking for staff or parents and buses. And I think message received, for sure. We were aware of that, and we have issues in other areas in the city of Stratford that are causing us concerns. So we'll totally understand that. Heather is asking what changes are available to Stratford since the Ontario government released their Build Modern Schools Faster. December, that was released on Monday, I think it was. I don't know. Do you want to say anything about that, Jack? Or do you want me to say something?
Sure. Thanks, Sherry.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, you know, the part that would be relevant to more schools build faster, to me, is not really yet relevant to a place like Stratford. What the memo was getting into with regards to that was trying to create you know, less red tape for schools who want to, or for boards who want to build schools in something like a condo, right? It, like, you know, a shared space, and that's what they're referring to. So that was really the, like, there's other stuff that's going to come out, but specifically, you know, the Build Modern Schools Faster memo that got released on December 11th, it was more speaking to that, which is more, you know, right now, a Toronto GTA kind of issue, where you're starting to see some plans for schools in you know, high-rise buildings. But it's not like, you know, never say never, because I had this proposal in Niagara-on-the-Lake a few months ago, but it's not something I would see happening in Stratford. Like, it's not I don't think in my career anyways, I don't think it's something that we're going to see in the next 10 years. But anyways, that's kind of what that change is referring to.
I think Hugh wants to add something about built ready.
Yeah. So, so the other piece of this government strategy is what they have is different construction technologies and pre-designed schools. So if you had a relatively flat site, they do have a catalog of school designs where boards can potentially just go to that catalog and pick out a school, and they don't need to necessarily go and get an architect to go through a 6 to 7 month long design period, and also tilt up schools, which are kind of like prefabricated buildings that can be put up very quickly, and they actually look not bad, but it's not necessarily to address 100% of this memo is not about addressing the red tape to get to the capital to build a new school. It's that once you have the capital, to make the process to getting into the ground much quicker.
Thank you, Hugh. And then Lindsay has a question about Area 3, which I think might be under, where's Area 3? Area 3 is hidden there. Okay, behind the arrow. Could Area 3 go to Downey? This option will show Downey underutilized. Any comments on that, Josh?
Yeah, we can take a look at that for sure. Again, the intention here was to keep those city students within the city, noting that there is some pressures at Hamlet. That might be the next viable option there. So that's something we'll take back and take a look at.
Okay, I think we'll maybe move to, I think we just have the one more option, but then we want to be able to have some overriding conversation too. So go ahead, Josh, and take us through option 3.
Yeah, for sure. So once we, so options 1 and 2 kind of dealt with, I'll say, a variety of these changes. This option 3 now includes all the same option that were prepared in option 1. However, option 2 remains at Avon there. That's really the only change here, is it does not move, but areas 1, 3, 4, 5, and 6, similar to what we see in option 1. So from a utilization perspective, note here, without that area directed, Avon, again, jumps up to above 110% over that longer period of time. But the downfall of that is Bedford really starts to fall as well. Its enrollment here now falls to around that 60% mark. We've moved that area 1 out, both 82 students, both French immersion and regular track, from Bedford to Anne Hathaway. Although Anne Hathaway receives that boost in enrollment, it really starts to deplete that at Bedford, along with those students being returned to their home site. And then again, here, this option looked at those growth areas of 5 and 6 going north to central Perth rather than to one of those sites within the city, that we may see some constraints there. So those are the three options. I'll say all similar in nature, some little tweaks here and there, and I think we've heard some feedback on a few of these areas that we may want to look at tweaking as well. So maybe I'll flip it back to see if there's any additionals on this one or any other areas.
Yeah, I think wanting to put out the questions for option 3, and then I think we staff and Watson would like to kind of have I wouldn't say a vote, but a sense from the committee about this, keeping area Stratford students in the city or moving them out, you know, what the preference would be. But just on this option alone, is there any questions or feedback or comments, Rick?
I'm curious why none of the three options have Area 3 going down Central, considering there's buses coming in and taking students from the other side of Alone Ave already. And why is that not been considered an option? And every one of your options shows Downey Central losing and losing and losing and losing population. So what's the reasoning behind that?
Again, part of that was to deal with the surplus space at Hamlet and Romeo, looking at option areas 3 and 4, kind of shuffling down to fill up those sites. Initially, we have the impression that if we can keep those students within that city, along with filling up those city sites, facilities, that'd probably be the preferred option. But again, that's something that we can look at, whether Area 3 is down to Downey or even travels north to Central Perth. Both have significant surplus space opportunities there, but would see some larger travel times as well.
And again, just to reiterate, right, like these are just like, these are options for discussion. Like, so exactly what's happening tonight is what we wanted to happen. Why not this area there? Like, we've had all these discussions internally, And we could have come out tonight and had like 82 options. And we thought, well, we had a bunch more options and it was getting really confusing, right? So it's better to, you know, just dice it up this way. And then, you know, now we can go back and go, hey, we heard Central Perth like 5 or 6 times tonight. We should probably look at Area 3 to Central Perth. Hey, we heard like Area 4, maybe not so much to, you know, Romeo, or, you know, maybe not so much filling up Shakespeare. Let's go look at that and see what that does. But again, just another reminder that goes back to the capital conversation, right? In our eyes, we keep getting this feedback from the ministry that we have to try to do something at the Stratford area schools. So that's what we've tried to do. But going back to Sherry's point, if we, after this process, hear loudly from the committee and the community and trustees that, you know, we want to fill up Downey and Central Perth, well, that's probably what's going to happen. And then our job is to go back to the ministry and say, look, we've done a full boundary review. We've tried to implement what you've wanted us to. We couldn't do it because we engage with our public and these were the feelings. And this is, but look what we've done. Like we have addressed surplus space here, and we've addressed surplus space here, and we still have this issue. So I hope that explains, like, none of these options, like, I don't see, like, you know, from my point of view anyways, is that, you know, when we go to the public, it's going to be option 1, 2, and 3 that we've showed you tonight. Maybe it is, but my gut, based on what I've heard so far tonight, is that it's not going to be that, right? So let's kind of keep going, right? It's all this, and then we're going to come back and show you some new stuff and go, here's why it works going to Central Perth, or we might come back and go, here's why it doesn't, and here's the busing implications, or here's how long those kids have to travel. And maybe going back to Sherry's point, like, integral, I think, in all of this is, you know, we want to get a sense, and maybe even before I say this, like, even if the vote, you know, is 12-8 that they want to see students staying in Stratford, I mean, we're still going to analyze it properly, but we want to get a sense of, you know, sort of what the committee wants in general, in or out.
Okay, that's great. Thanks. I've got a number of comments. Just Lindsay's commented that kind of connects to the last comment that was made. Would like to see more considerations for push of students to Downey. In all scenarios, Downey numbers are low. She does understand the daycare situation and busing, but there's another kind of support for considering Downey. And then I think next I have Danielle. Go ahead, Danielle. You take yourself off mute.
Sorry, I was just on another screen. Just one question there. I wasn't sure how the numbers for Anne Hathaway increased so much on this one compared to the last one, but maybe it was just, maybe I wasn't looking that far ahead on the Anne Hathaway slide. And then just on Area 1, should the line for the boundary be at Romeo Street moving down into Anne Hathaway and not over? It looks like it's just slightly over past Romeo. So two-part question. Sorry, the first part just being, was there additional factors that would increase the enrollment in Anne Hathaway on this option versus the one previous? And then secondly, just Area 1 boundary line there on Romeo Street.
So I can start. So no, there was no other implication. So we'll take a look at that. I think they are the same. I don't have them separate, but Anne Hathaway should remain relatively similar. In options, you might have just not caught objecting the thumbs up there. As for the Romeo Street change, as you see there, we are extending just beyond that Romeo to both east and west. And what the boundary is really doing there is just capturing students on both sides of that street, and taking them as they are already, and directing them to one school. So there isn't necessarily a bus from the east side grabbing students, and then a bus from the west side also grabbing additional students and sending them different ways. So that's probably what we're looking at there.
Okay, thank you.
A comment from Paul about just questioning why we didn't offer solution such as moving the FI students from Bedford to Anne Hathaway, and then moving some English students from Avon over to Bedford, and moving English from Anne Hathaway to Romeo, Hamlet, and Shakespeare. I assume you've considered it, but I can't think of why it wouldn't work. It would also provide a single site for FI. And I do believe this is what we kind of got into talking about last time, is about the 50% rule, right? We'd be deemed to moving more than 50% of the school, the building. So then we would have a problem. Okay, so maybe we could, Josh, you want to, Paul's just responding saying he doesn't think more than 50% would go.
So I'll say the FI change wouldn't necessarily capture that 50%. It's actually the regular track. So if we're moving that regular track program out of a site at Anne Hathaway, I think it's 65%, and then Bedford just over at 57%. But if we are to move A or B of those programs, we do have to displace the opposite program. So that's where that 50% comes into play.
Okay. So the answer is yes, you consider, but because it wasn't allowed under the 50% rule at the receiving school, we couldn't offer it as a solution. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then I think next is Morgan, who's been waiting patiently for comment.
So this one kind of popped into my head after I saw Paul asking about the FI. Waterloo School Board does not have specific sites. Every school has French immersion starting at grade one. Is this something that could be considered, and that every school in Stratford just has a better, more extensive French program starting in grade one through to grade eight, or well, I guess six. I guess we could include the intermediate school. And then it's not two specific sites, and every school offers it, and we don't get into the, well, Anne Hathaway gives this, Bedford gives that, Avon has this, and they're just all offering the same thing, and they all stay in the home schools.
Do you want me to start?
No. I could be blunt and say no. Like, it in a perfect world with unlimited funds, sure. The reality is the way the board is funded, and more importantly, from a resource perspective. I was just talking with another board about this, with the viability of a French immersion program. Typically, a French immersion program person told me today that unless you have kind of like, I think it was somewhere between 30 to like 40, even 50% of the school French immersion, gets very difficult to staff it properly and to fund it properly. So it would, while it'd be great to offer at every school, there's just not the critical mass of students in Avon's jurisdiction to do that. But Sherry, you're the numbers person and the dollars person, so you can probably speak to that even more.
Yeah, I think what it would come down to is if we were to do it within the funding that was provided from the ministry, you'd be looking at quadruple grades, like because it's all about the class size. So you would, the reason why a one track or even the two track schools is more efficient is that you can fill up the French classrooms and you can fill up the English classrooms without having to split as many times in the grades. But if you were to only have, a school with 200 kids and 40 of them or 50 of them were taking French immersion, you'd literally have two classes for grades one to six. And it's just not practical from a teaching perspective to have triple or quadruple grades. I don't think any really, going back to the one room schoolhouse. So it's not, the funding's not really designed to kind of allow our smaller schools to have dual track, unfortunately. It's a grand idea if we had larger schools in all of the area, but that's not our reality.
That makes sense. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. And then I think next on my list, that's your hand, Morgan. So I'm assuming that's asked and answered. And then next would be Sean.
I just a question. So if, because I think that part of the problem with Area 4 is having to cross Erie Street. My assumption is the density of Area 3 is greater than the density of Area 4. I think I remember that, but I could be wrong. And obviously, it's the same six areas in all slides, right? So you guys have done a good job of really looking at where that population is, where it's going to go, and where it makes the most sense. If 3 is a higher population than 4, Would it be possible or a thought just to swap those areas, have 4 go to Avon, 3 go to Hamlet? And I don't know. I'm basically looking at this for the first time, like most other people, and just spitting out ideas, right? But if 4 is, say, 47 students or something like that, and I don't know what 3 is, I know it seems silly to swap them. But if the projected population increase in Area 4 is less dense than Area 3, then you don't have to cross. You don't have to cross a major street, and I think they would all still be within the 1.6.
So the Area 4, a good chunk of them, it looks like, would be over that 1.6. I know the rail might pose a hazard for transportation going north to Avon. Right now, they're all pretty well walked just to Hamlet. Area 3, you were right, it is a more dense population there, and then there are additional growth happening as well. So that's what I'll say could be a possibility, but you would be making potential walkers may require some transportation to go north to Avon.
Yeah, it's something we'll definitely look at. It's not going to have this, obviously, right, not the same impact at Avon, but... You know, if we're comfortable and staff tells us, like, hey, maybe if we even get to 115% utilization at Avon, that's, you know, acceptable, then yeah, definitely it's just going to have a less net impact doing it that way, but for sure. Because it sounds like Area 4. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm not necessarily advocating for it. Yeah. I was just looking at the map for the first time, wondering if there's another way to reconfigure things.
Yeah. Like, I think probably our immediate next step, like consultant and board staff, is to give Area 4 to the board's transportation department and say, is this, you know, we heard from the committee members that this is going to be a hazardous area that they're probably not going to be able to walk anyways. And if we have that determination, then we can say, okay, maybe Area 4 is something we can play with a little bit more, because if it moves, it's going to get bussed, maybe regardless of where it goes, right? Or maybe it just ends up staying at Hamlet and we do something else. But yeah, all good points. I agree.
If I may just offer a comment on option 2, which is kind of connected to transportation. I am concerned about the busing congestion of this option. And also then, like Romeo and Shakespeare, for the reasons noted, having buses in that area is just makes me quite anxious. And really anxious about bringing areas 5 and 6 into Shakespeare, just because of the crossing of buses. It just stresses me out quite a bit. So yeah, Jack, I would really like to be able to take that Area 4 question to the transportation team, because I'm feeling very similar to some of the sentiment that I'm not sure how we cross Area 4 into Romeo easily. So that would be from a transportation perspective, right? If we're not comfortable with the kids walking. So that would be good feedback. Okay, and you're not here for my opinion anyway, so I got to move on. And just a comment going back, trying to keep things in order. Cora had mentioned, I think it was in a question about kind of all the changes that we were contemplating earlier, mentioning, you know, she has understanding our, you know, fewest number of changes makes sense, and she understands what our thinking was at the time. One more comment, and then I'll go back to the question from Janie. Could the section of Hamlet on the opposite side of Erie be moved to Romeo, and then Area 4 and 3 could be at Hamlet? And I think this is relation to option 3. I think that's when the question came up anyway, when option 3 was on the screen. So again, could the section of Hamlet on the opposite side of Erie be moved to Romeo, and then Area 4 and 3 could both be at Hamlet?
Maybe if Janie, it was Janie?
Yes.
Yeah, if she's on, can you, I'm not sure which area of Erie. Josh, do you? You're on mute.
No, I was going to say the opposite side of 4 of Erie already goes to Romeo, so I don't know if there was another portion of Erie to go there.
Janie, are you available to speak to this by any chance? South of Lauren Ave, Hamlet.
Hi, students. This is Janie. Oh.
Hi, Janie. Sorry. Go ahead.
We go to Hamlet, obviously. I thought there was like a little section on the other side of Erie from Hamlet that came into Hamlet, but I'm possibly mistaken. I was just reading this chart wrong, I think. So ignore me.
Yeah, no, Erie is the divider. I think this map might show it a little cleaner between Hamlet and Romeo.
Okay, that makes sense.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And then Michael, go ahead.
Hey, yeah, I'm going to be really careful not to present my own opinion on the different scenarios. I'm going to try to just kind of take from what the community is saying. But I would say I would echo the concerns around Area 4 crossing the Erie Street. I think that's something that would be difficult to support having, like, without some sort of a real strong safety plan in place. That makes sense to me. And I think, Sherry, what you were saying about buses into the Shakespeare area, when I think of places that I get the most phone calls about in regards to traffic already, it tends to be the Romeo Shakespeare areas. So the idea of adding a lot more traffic in there, buses, we'd have to really take that, I think, into consideration as well. So, but I really appreciate the different perspectives and questions that have been asked. They're bang on. So great. Thanks.
Thank you. For those that don't know, Michael is one of our Stratford area trustees. So that was good commentary there, Trustee Bannerman. Thank you. A comment from Morgan. Option two seems to be the least ideal option, I think, when we were talking about option two. And then I think now I move to Rick. Has a comment or question?
Yeah, I think you're going to be hard pressed to increase any of the catchment zones for Romeo. Like if you know the city at all and you see where the borders are of Romeo on this map, you're showing the gray area to the east side, the right hand of the map. That's a major road at Romeo Street, and then you have the river, you have the train station to the south of it, and then you get Erie Street on, and then into the Shakespeare School. So you're going to be really hard pressed to find any way without shipping kids in on buses, which the streets around Romeo School are barely wide enough for two cars, let alone buses and cars to be getting in there.
Hugh, did you have a comment to add to that?
Just that we totally agree with what you're saying, and we've made that, and Jack's referenced it too. We've made that comment to the ministry in our business cases to put additions on schools in Stratford to increase capacity where we have pressures that geographically the streets and the river and the railroad track and all these things, it's absolutely in our business cases to say we just may not have the ability to address capacities at Romeo and Shakespeare for precisely the reasons that you're saying. So those are well taken comments.
Okay, and then comment from Katrina. So what about Area 1 and Area 2? Area 1 and Area 2, area to designated area. And then Area 3 to Downey, leave Area 4 at Hamlet, Area 5 and 6 to Central Perth. Did everybody get all that? So Area 1 and 2 move as proposed, I think under option 1. Area 3 to Downey, leave Area 4 at Hamlet, so that fixes that not crossing Erie Street there, we've been talking about, and Area 5 and 6 to Central Perth. Did I capture that right, Katrina? Yeah, got a thumbs up on that one. Okay.
I mean, I think that's an option we have to look at. Like, I mean, we've heard it now 10 times tonight, probably. So 100% we'll look at that one.
Okay. And then Andrea was responding, I think, trying to clarify for an earlier comment about the Hamlet catchment. James is commenting, having had a student attend Shakespeare, the idea of busing into that school is not feasible. There's already a huge congestion issue with cars on very narrow streets. Yeah, this is just, we keep on bumping up against the same traffic issues that at these two schools, at Shakespeare and Romeo, we actually experience at some of our other schools, like Avalon in particular. Yeah, well taken, James. That's for sure. Does anybody have anything else they wanted to say or discuss? Feedback?
Can I ask another question?
Of course you can.
I feel like it's my... anyways, is there anyone on the call tonight that lives in Area 3 or that has friends or people that they've talked to in Area 3?
Morgan's got her hand up, Morgan. And
I sort of do. So I have friends that live in the Jen Ann subdivision, and that goes to Downey. So their concern is, why does that go to Downey Central? But then Area 3 schools are going into Avon. And so these people, they border cross their children to Avon simply because Downey Central, they can't feasibly get them to school or even onto the bus because the parent herself is a teacher at Central Perth. And so she's seeing, like, you know, if she has to pick her kids up for an appointment or hockey, anything at the end of the day, she pulls them out of school early because she can't get in to get them and then get back out because of, again, parking, traffic, all that nonsense. And because of the traffic, they can't walk. But she's looking at this saying, well, why do we go out of town, but these other kids that are on the other side, even more rural technically, are coming into town and creating more problems?
Okay.
Is that the subdivision here that we're referencing that gets shipped down?
That subdivision already exists. Like, the Jen Ann is right where your cursor is, but closer to where it says Olone. Like, basically up where the green meets the... Yes, so that's the Jen Ann subdivision. And then Area 3 is all new. It's full of young families. These boundaries already exist, and these kids are already coming to Avon.
Mm-hmm.
So that... And I was speaking with this woman just this weekend, and so these are her concerns, and I'm like, yeah, that's valid.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And then Heather, I wondered if you were answering Jack's question, if there's anybody that has friends in the area. I don't know if you had anything you wanted to add to Morgan's comments there, based on what you know. Feel free to speak up if you'd like to. Cora is commenting that they live on Front and it's barely manageable with traffic and we're the walkers. So, and then Romeo, regarding the Romeo public school traffic. Okay. And Rick has friends in Area 3. Did you make, you have a comment, Rick, you wanted to mention about that or anything?
I think Hugh was ahead of me.
Oh, Hugh was responding. Sorry, Hugh. Sorry.
That's a legacy hand. Sorry.
You're good. No, you're good to go, Rick.
I do have friends that live in the area. I do feel for those in Area 3 that are used to having that short drive to Avon School. But there's not going to be a solution where everybody is happy with where they end up. But the population of Avon School right now cannot be maintained. Like, it's not even if we move Area 5 and 6 out and keep Area 3, you even showed us the amount of kids that are living in that area that are coming into that school. It's not.
Oops, sweetie, be careful.
There's way too many. Just adding more and more portables is not an option. And with the way, Hugh, that you've been talking about how the business process goes to getting funds for capital, we're not going to end up getting capital to do anything because there's empty seats at Downey Central. There's empty seats at Shakespeare. There's empty seats at Romeo. Somebody has to have an uncomfortable change in order for any of this to work. And I think that's kind of the point of this committee, is just to kind of get all that in. But I just need to say that, like, there's the most obvious option is to have Area 3 move to Downey Central, where they originally were supposed to be until 2018 or 2019, where they got moved into the Avon catchment area, which really shouldn't have been allowed in the first place.
Thanks, Rick, for that. Carrie had commented about living in Area 3. And I'm wondering, I do not know many families would choose for the children to go out of town. I think that's maybe what you're saying in your comment, is that you do not know of families? Yes, okay, yeah. So in that area, moving the kids out of town is what your concern would be. Heather is commenting, I think the argument for having kids go to Stratford schools when you live in Stratford is the main concern for Area 3 families. Yes, that's kind of what our thought had been originally. And then a comment from Carrie about before and after school care and the distance from home are concerns. And I think that comment would be relevant for Area 3, 5, and 6. I know 5, I don't think 5 has any development right now, but would be the same comment, I'm sure, from those communities about before and after school. And I think, Danielle, go ahead.
Just with areas, 5, 3, 5, and 6, are they considered, like for French immersion, would they be in the boundary to go to Anne Hathaway, or are they considered out of town and they'd go to Bedford for French immersion? Would that change, or changing any of those, would that impact some of those pressures?
I guess that's an option to consider. For Area 1, we did make that change with that feeder alignment. But 5 and 6, yeah, right now they are currently going to Anne Hathaway. They are part of that city community that are attending. So if they are part of that rural, the expectation from Watson side would be to keep them with their community. So yes, they would be changing as well.
So then they would go to Bedford for French immersion.
Correct.
I think that might encourage more of those families, if they're wanting to stay in the city, to choose French immersion. I don't know if that's, you know, positive or negative, but at least that gives them the option still of having a school in the city.
And then I think Laura, go ahead.
Hi, I just wanted to point out that when we're talking about Area 3, I know from a lot of children that I know that come from that area, they're all bused into Avon, even though it's not very far. It looked like it would be walking distance. I'd say only the older 2 grades would walk or bike, but I don't see how there would be a huge difference to bus the majority of the kids from that area to one school, or to bus them out a little farther into the country.
Okay, that's good feedback. Thank you, Laura. Anybody else have anything before we move to kind of what our thinking is for next steps? Carrie, go ahead.
I just wanted to say that my own children started at Downey, and it was about a 30-minute bus ride. To Avon, it was 5. It's a very huge difference in busing time, and the time that they got back to the city was quite a bit later. It really does impact family schedules quite a bit. And also the fact that there is no before and after school care. You have to be at the bus stop to receive your small children. There really isn't another option other than having a neighborhood babysitter to be able to collect them.
Yeah, good points. Katrina has a comment about for the before and after concerns, would it be possible to bus the kids from Downey or Central Perth to a school in town for care? So we do, the transportation policy does allow transportation within the catchment area. So if you attend a school, let's just say Downey, if you attend Downey and you live in one address, but your child care is in a different address, the transportation policy will allow alternate pickup or drop off as long as it's consistent. So say the student, it picks up in the morning at home, but has to go to, for child care reasons, to a different address at the end of the day, then the bus would be provided as long as it's every day of the week and not changing every single day. So it would have to be within that same catchment. I'm not sure if that answers your question, Katrina. You want to go ahead?
I meant to Avon for their before and after school program. Yeah. And catch into there. I know that Dublin School buses to Perth Care for Kids in Mitchell for their care. For their school program.
The Catholic board, the Catholic school, yeah, in Dublin.
The Dublin Catholic School buses their kids to Mitchell for before and after school. So I didn't know if it might be an option to
bus. They bus them there after school. They leave Dublin on the bus and go to Mitchell. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Well, I think technically that would be within the same catchment, I'm guessing, because it's such a, their catchment would be a lot bigger, right, than ours, because they have less schools. Yeah,
I just didn't know if it was an option.
Yeah.
Something to think about.
They do follow the same policy as we do. It's the same. So they should be following that same policy. So my guess is Dublin, Mitchell must be within the same catchment of the school in Dublin, which is why it's allowed under the policy.
The other part, and I think Rick touched on it, is you have to have room at the schools that have the before and after care. So even if conceivably you can bus them back to Stratford for before and after, you would need the spaces, which doesn't sound like there's many of them, at least not at Avon.
There's a comment from Heather about, I think, timelines for transition. Will schools be grandfathered or legacied, is the term we like to use, through the current school when the changes are in effect? And I guess that's really the big question is, you know, would it change, would it be a transitional time other than just that 1 year of transition? So say the decisions made by the trustees in the spring of 2024 for September 2025, would there be any kind of acknowledgement or plan to kind of transition slowly the students that are currently impacted? That's a tough one. We'd have to crunch the numbers. We have a real big urgency, obviously, with Avon in particular, that a slow transition, slower than 2 year transition, might be challenging. So I'm not sure if you guys, Hugh or Jack or Josh, have any advice on that.
Yeah, I comment really quickly. It's exactly what Sherry said. Ultimately, it's going to depend on the numbers, and we'll run all those analyses for the committee and say, if you legacied everybody, here's how many students would move and here's how long it would take, and maybe you don't effectively do anything for a decade. Typically around the province, like, again, using my experience working for other boards, typically what we see is legacy of grade 7 students, right? So grade 8s, you assume like they're going to already be graduating from the system by the time the decision happens. So, you know, like Sherry said, maybe if the decision is delayed for a year, that effectively takes care of legacy existing grade 7 and 8s just because of the length of the time. That's typical, is grade 7 and 8s. Grade 8s are already gone. Grade 7, I would say, is typical. They've been in the school for 9 years. You let them finish, but ultimately it's going to depend on what Sherry said, the number crunching that has to go on.
Yeah. And obviously in many of our schools, you mean grade 5 and 6, not grade 7.
Oh, grade 5 and 6 in this case.
Some are 7 and 8. Okay. I'm wanting to make sure we get to the last slide before 8. So comment from Rick, effectively, there's no before and after school care at Avon anyway, due to excessive enrollment. Yes, that's a big challenge. Danielle says, I think all before and after school programs have our capacity. No Avon and Bedford both have no space. Agreed. Same with Hamlet. Yes. And then Heather's comment about grade five students in our case of the K to six schools. Yeah. Same concept, Heather, that I just kind of mentioned. Laura, is that legacy hand up? Did you have something more to add? Okay, assuming no. And then Carrie, same with you. Did you want to add something?
Yes. So as I said, my daughter started at Downey, then was moved to Avon. She's now at SIS. So, I mean, for her, obviously, she's in grade seven. This decision would be probably, you know, after she's in high school. However, there's definitely kids here now in grade six thinking they're going to SIS. So that's going to be a huge, you know, change of mind frame to then go to Downey for grade seven and eight.
Oh, it's a huge consideration. Yeah, that's actually a good point. Obviously, any students within, that's, make sure that we keep track of that, Josh, please, that the students that are slated to go to SIS, definitely. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Carrie. That's a great point. We would want to address that, make sure those kids continue 7-8 at SIS before they move on. Okay. A comment from, or question from Lindsay, do we know if the CMSM has new service providers coming on board for before and after school? Is the shortage due to funding or staff to run them? So our understanding is Hugh and I meet regularly with the CMSMs for both counties. Our understanding, the gap is staffing, definitely staffing. It's not as much funding, maybe more funding in order to compensate staff at a level that they can keep staff, but it's finding people. And I know they've got some ideas on how to do some recruitment and to staff up. That's right, Hugh. There's no, Darren, it's staffing is the biggest issue.
It's staffing. I think they're, I mean, in our conversations, I believe they're doing everything they can do from, I think they have accepting some untrained staff and trying to get them into training through some training they're offering, adult ed and some college programs are trying to get people into to get trained staff. So there's even some cases in the board where they're unlicensed programs or rec programs that are happening instead of licensed programs to try and get some before care. So I believe within the system, people are doing what they can do, but there's just not the staff to put in place that to make safe programs.
I do feel that the Perth County CMSM is having more success than in Huron County for sure. And, you know, when we are expanding childcare programming in two of our regions, not within Stratford, but, you know, we're looking at the Milverton funding and in Listowel, they seem very optimistic. They'll have no problem staffing those areas. But yeah, within the city of Stratford, we continually ask. And so this would be something that if we collect feedback, Watson team, from the community about this whole notion of childcare before and after, we could also then take it to our CMSM and say, if this were to happen, what would be the likelihood that we could get a before and after school program at Downey or Central Perth or what have you?
Yeah.
Big, a great connection.
In some cases, even where there's been some viable programs, we've had providers say, I'm sorry, we just can't provide a program there next year, even though the viability study would say, I think it's the magic number, if I'm not mistaken, is 12 or something like that to make a viable program. And even in those cases, they have had to pull out because they just don't have the staff.
Yeah, I mean, a few years ago, I would always respond to the community like this. If they asked, you know, if we're moving, there's no before and after program, you're going to move, you know, 80 kids to this school. And I was always pretty confident that I would say, don't worry, if 80 kids are moving and there's a need for a program, someone's going to show up with a program. To Hugh's point, now it's not necessarily are there the kids necessary to make a program viable. It's more to Sherry and Hugh's point and everyone, I think it's, do we have staff that we're going to be able to staff the program with? And that answer is coming up, unfortunately, no, a lot. And this is, you know, for everyone's benefit on the committee, like, again, for someone who works around the province, this is not a Stratford problem or an Avon problem. This is an Ontario, this is probably a Canada problem right now, but it's definitely an Ontario problem right now.
Yeah, for sure. But we can still advocate on behalf of the school board, obviously, and we would continue to do that. But it would be nice to have some data to take to the CMSM to say, this is what our community is saying about where they would like to see before and after school. We do that currently based on the survey, but if we make a change to borders or boundaries. I think we better maybe get to the next step slide and just kind of summarize. And then if there's people that have further questions, we can take that. But I just want to honor that some might need to leave at 8 o'clock. I think, Carrie, your hand is a legacy hand. It's been, I think. So next steps is we will be, so Watson is asking for a survey again. And it's, I had a peek at it this afternoon. It's pretty technical. But we're going to actually, I think, Josh, you've got it designed to ask, this is the option, tell us what you feel. This is the option, tell us what you feel. This is the option, we'll tell you what you feel, right? Pretty technical. But the maps and the tables are within the survey. So really wanting to make sure that we get everybody's voice. So please, committee members, please complete that survey when it comes out. This is probably the most important survey we'll have. And add your comments that we've talked about or reiterate what you've already said. Our next step then would be, so Watson will collect that survey results, I think, and it's slated to be open for about a week and a half or so. We'll take that and do some consolidation analysis. Staff don't actually see the detail, the by-person response. We just see the summarized responses like you do. But that would be, Watson will be using that feedback to kind of modify and adjust the options that they would put out for public consultation. And the public consultation will come out via, it'll be a report along with a survey to the community. And so what we'll do, I think their Watson team is we'll get the report and the survey, and we'll send it out to the committee members a couple days before it goes out to the community, or a day before it goes out to the community. And then obviously we want it to go to our trustees and to the community all at once. And then there'll be a big splash where we're asking everybody to complete. So your role as a committee member will be to advocate your school community to please complete the survey individually, and that would be really helpful. Generally, when we have a consultation like that, we do get a lot of questions because obviously members of the community haven't been part of these discussions, and so hopefully we can support the community by kind of directing them to the website, watch the videos of the meetings, and hopefully there's some resources there. There's a question from Roxy about will we see the final options ahead of the public consultation. I think that's the intention of me sending the, you know, my comment just now, but sending it to the group before it goes out to the public so that you can have a look at it before. Once we get that consultation back, again, that goes directly to Watson, then our job will be, Watson team's job will be to kind of consolidate the feedback and bring it back to the committee on February 15th. So our next meeting will really be looking at the feedback from the committee. Is that correct, Jack and Josh, right? Or sorry, from the community, where the committee can go, see, the community felt the same as we did, or, the community did not feel the same as we did. So that's an important piece of information and discussion. The results of that February 15th meeting will be hopefully where we kind of come to a common understanding of what we feel we should be putting forward to the trustees, or some options for consideration, or an option for consideration. And that would go to the trustees that were slated for the April board meeting. And it's highly unlikely we'll have a decision in the same night. In fact, I think the trustees have asked that we don't ask them for a decision in the same night because they need time to unpack and think and ask questions and so forth. Last time we did this, we allowed, I think it was two two sets of board meetings before a decision was finally made. So even though it goes to the trustees in April, they'll need time to delegate and think and digest the information. So that's the next steps. We'll watch for Laura will send out the survey tomorrow to the committee to respond to. And I think, is there anything else I'm forgetting to add, team? Watson, Hugh, I got everything?
I guess just one thing of yes. When we go to the public, they are essentially preliminary options, right? We are going back to the committee for that final review as well. So I did see a comment about, are those the final options going to the public? No, there is still some feedback and consultation that we'll do with the committee.
Right. Sorry. Thank you for that important clarification, Josh. Yeah. So whenever we get back from the community is still subject, it's not final, it's still subject. The whole purpose is to do a check-in with the community to see if we're on the right track or not. Okay, so there will be a chance to see final options before it goes to the trustees, for sure. Do I have anybody else? If you need to go ahead, but we don't have any more content, but if anybody has any other questions, we'd be happy to stick around for a few more minutes and answer questions or hear thoughts. Nothing more. Hopefully this online format was okay. We were a little nervous about doing this online as opposed to doing it in person. Our preference was to do in person, but with all the sicknesses that are around the area right now, I think it's great that that we were able to do this and everyone was able to attend. Morgan, did you have something?
Yeah, I'm just wondering when we put it out to the community, how does that look? Like, how does it go out to the committee? Is it like a pamphlet sent home with your kids?
Yeah.
Do they give their feedback?
So what we do is our communications department will actually do a media release. So that's one mechanism. It'll go through the media. So because we want everybody to see it. And then also it will go to the school principals who will include the information in what we call the youngest and only, you know, in the backpacks or whatever, or through social media, whatever mechanism makes sense. We do have, we will have an option to collect feedback on paper. So if people aren't comfortable with technology, we want them to be able to do the survey on paper. We've offered that in the past and had a handful of people who prefer the paper version. So we're kind of looking for multiple ways to collect that, but electronically is what our hope is through a survey. But you'll probably, as a committee member, see a lot, you know, we'll see something from the media, you'll see something from your school principal, your school messenger, whatever the communication that happens at your school, the newsletters, we've got a blurb in the newsletters that we're just going to be inundated with reminders to ask people to please do that survey. The media has been really good at picking up, so hopefully they do again this time. And really kind of promoted in the local media. I have a couple reporters that call me pretty regularly when it comes to this process, so we'd encourage that as well. Does that answer your question, Morgan?
Yes, thank you.
Thanks. And obviously advocate to your neighbors and friends and family to please complete the survey. What we don't want is only one school community voice. We'd like a variety of voice, right? So all communities are represented. Does anybody have anything else? Okay. Well, thank you everybody for your participation. I really, really appreciate the good conversation. And if you celebrate the holidays, have happy holidays. And if not, enjoy a bit of a break in the next little while.
Thanks, everybody.
You. Laura, you can stop the recording.